Your honorable teachers, my good friends, faculty members of Hyderabad National Law University, my dear students, dear Vice Chancellor, what I just now told is, I am coming from the most polluted city of India, city of the world, and when I have abundant oxygen here, I was thrilled. I am getting new energy, so I thank you for your oxygen. Then, why I should talk about oxygen? Because in a democracy, information is oxygen. And we are starved of oxygen in this country. Starved of relevant information. You may have a glut of information. Google is there, of course I know. For everything you check with Google, just to dial is also there. But now I am not talking about that information. The information which empowers you, information that that makes you vibrant, information that makes you questioning the authorities for not doing the promised work, not doing the expected work, not doing the work assigned to them according to constitution or rule of law. That is the problem. Then when you call yourself a democracy, when you have a right to know, when you have a right to live, when you have a right to think, and you have also a right to express. But my question is, how do you do all these things without information? What do you think? How do you exercise your right of liberty of thinking without information? What should you think about? And what is that you express? What is that you criticize when you do not know? What a so-and-so public office is expected to do to you? Why not they tell you what they are about to do? What they are supposed to do? Why not they tell? Why not they tell you when do you get your ration card? Why not they tell you if we cannot give you a ration card within 30 days, I'll pay you some penalty. This is the alternative course. Why not they do? So these are all questions of governance. These are all questions of democratic living in a society where the rule of law is expected to function, expected to operate. Then why are you not giving this information? All of you know, when we got independence, when we got relieved of slavery, now before we got relieved of slavery, do you know what we were relieved of? We were relieved of our ignorance. Ignorance about the bad aspects of British rule. Ignorance about our slavery. Ignorance about our self-rule and self-independence. We were ignorant of it. And all the leaders, you name any leader of that age, they were journalists. All of us think that most of the lawyers are the leaders in pre-independence movement. To a great extent, you are right. But every leader was a journalist, every leader was a writer, every leader was a speaker, every leader was trying to spread education against ignorance. Every leader was trying to empower the people with wonderful information. And I consider that kind of vibrancy, that kind of consciousness, that kind of awareness has made the people to stand up against the strongest regime of the world, that is British regime, and we could achieve independence. And if knowledge can lead you to independence, knowledge is also necessary for you to run your independent country. I'm asking you, do you have complete knowledge about the government that is working for you? Do you have complete knowledge about government of India that is working for you? I'm not talking about politics. I'm not interested in chief ministers and prime ministers. I'm interested in systems, working systems, to make systems work. That's my interest. That should be your interest also. I'll just give you one example to tell you what is the authority of information. President of India, you know, President of India is the highest seat of office in this country. And after retirement of President, President will be given a choice of living for the rest of life at a place where he wants to, where she or he wants to live. For President Pratibha Patil, they were building a huge building in Pune. Pune she chose to live after her retirement as president. And it was a very huge building. Somebody wanted to know for whom this building is being built. Then they told it is for Pratibha Patil. She is yet to retire. She is in the office. In the fifth year of her office, the building is started. Because immediately after retirement, she has to move. Then such a big building for President of India was the next question. Third question, why should they take army of the ex-army officers for whom it was allotted? Why that land has to be taken? So these were the questions generating among the people who were watching this building coming up. You know what they did? They wanted to know what are the eligibilities of retired prime president. What are the eligibilities according to law? Very simple, straight question. No controversy, no corruption related, sensational related aspect. It was not a sensational media, sensational question. It was just a simple question. They answered. They gave an authentic copy of the eligibilities of a retired president. And according to that, the retired president is eligible for 500 square yards of space with some amount of square feet of built-in area. And it is almost double or more than three or four times more than what she is eligible. And they immediately understood that what is going on is against the rule of law, against the norms, and she is not entitled to all that kind of big sprawling building. Then they simply held a press conference, asked the media people to come, and in the press conference they explained this is what is allotted to her and this is the rule. You know what happened next? The president of India has to surrender her option to live in Pune in such a building and opted back to what she is eligible for. I think a simple question has saved crores of rupees, not only crores of rupees to the nation, but it facilitated implementation of a law which is made by the nation to the first citizen, President of India. Now tell me if a right to information or a piece of information that you sought under right to information can make president to adhere to the norms, what it cannot make, what it cannot do. You understand the power of the information? This is the power of the information. And you can simply make people to work according to norms. Only thing you require is you should know the norms. And another thing I would like to say about her, she has shifted all those beautiful, valuable mementos from the Rashtrapati Bhavan. She has shifted them because they're very beautiful, no? Very costly gifts, rare gifts, wonderful gifts, beautiful gifts you'll get. Then somebody filed a right to information question saying that how many of such gifts are given to her, whether they are in the Rashtrapati Bhavan or where, if not, where are they placed? That was a simple question. Then do you know what was the answer? Answer was no information was given until all those artifacts, all those souvenirs, all those mementos came back to Rashtrapati Bhavan. Answer was not given. But we are least bothered over the answer. In sometimes, you know, we ask for information, but we ask for information for something else. What is that something else? Get back all those things. All of them came back, and you know, next it was Abdul Kalam. Do you know what Abdul Kalam did? Abdul Kalam said, whichever gift comes to Rashtrapati Bhavan, whether abroad or in India, it should be listed, photographed, registered, and then kept in a museum. Or if it is useful for anybody, it should be given to them. So a system has come into place because of a question. If you don't question, systems do not run. If you don't question, systems do not come in place. And if you don't question, things will go on as desired by the people in power. It could be corruption, it could be anything. I'd like to tell you how corruption is a very, very terrible disease. You all know that, but I'd like to give an example. You know, Rajiv Gandhi was assassinated. One of the lawyers of the accused in Rajiv Gandhi assassination case held a press conference in Chennai. I don't know for what he is telling is true, but I'm trying to tell you what must have happened. You imagine for this. I'm not giving a guarantee that it's a truthful information, but it's the information I read in the newspapers. He says, Nalini and Thanu, who were the killers of Rajiv Gandhi, they were about to enter, they were trying to cross the second security circle in Perumbulur on that day, that fateful day. They were prevented. They were rightly prevented because they were not having some that court, this court, we don't know. Then what that advocate says is, the lawyer of that says is, she flashed 100 rupee note and gained an entry. She gained an entry and you know the consequences. Now you tell me who killed Rajiv Gandhi. Is it terrorists alone? Or our own great character? Or is it something else? No, I could only tell which one factor which I came to know. after a huge lapse of time after the assassination of Rajiv Gandhi, I could tell you. But we don't know how many systemic failures have happened. How many people were inefficiently handling the security portfolio? We do not know how many people were not efficiently handling the intelligence portfolio. We don't know. So all that put together must be the reason for the murder. I remember one police officer, very honest, sincere and brave officer in Hyderabad. He fell to the bullets of ISI terrorists in 1992. Can you imagine 1992 ISI terrorists in Hyderabad? Can you imagine that? Now it is very common, you will find ISI terrorists everywhere. But in 1992, it was unimaginable, unexpected. And they were having AK-56. AK-47 was the latest weapon at that point of time. And AK-56, one of the advanced weapons, they were having it. And intelligence, Hyderabad police do not know. Intelligence do not know that, about it. This officer came to know that something is happening in the old city of Hyderabad, some conspiracy to kill the innocent people. And he rushed, he opened the door. They opened AK-56. Nobody knows AK-56 is available with that. And then he lost his life. Very efficient officer, young officer, additional SP. He lost his life. We were talking about him in the recent October 21st. You know, it is Martyrs Day in our country. We celebrate, we remember those martyrs on October 21st. Then what happened? A culprit was caught. His crime was proved. A terrorist. His name is Mujib Ahmed. He was put in Vishakhapatnam jail. And there I was told, it's again a media news, that he was supplied with 3 cell phones by the jail officers themselves. 3 cell phones. And he was keeping in contact with JKLF continuously. Then another wonder is, you have this remissions available on Independence Day. Remission is available on Independence Day to whom? To an ordinary traditional crime criminal. But this was extended to a terrorist. What a wonderful governance we have. Extended to a terrorist, and he was released 2 years in advance. And do you know what he insisted upon? He wanted to be taken to Hyderabad from Vishakhapatnam with police escort. So they saw him off and bye-bye, cheerio. And this fellow joined again, terrorist, committed some more terrorist act, again caught, and then he jumped the police custody. What I am trying to tell you is, when systems are suffering with this kind of inefficiency and corruption, only weapon that you have is to seek information. Nobody was asking Vishakhapatnam jail why, what kind of facilities you are extending to the terrorists. Nobody was asking those questions. And if we people who are educated, if we keep quiet, what will happen? I'd like to tell you, do you know the Bofors scandal? Have you heard of Bofors scandal? Do you know who revealed it? Any idea? You say some Hindu reporter and Chitra Subramaniam and N. Ram. You say that. Fine. Yes. In India, they are the brave journalists who exposed it. But originally, the tips came from Swedish radio. Swedish radio. That means Swedish official radio, like your Akashwani here. You tell me, can you expect Akashwani to tell such sensational news? You can't expect, when an official controlled, government controlled media, you can't expect it to reveal such information. But it was a government controlled media in Sweden. It was talking about the Swedish company paying tips to Indian administrators. I don't know who the administrators are. It was never established. So Indian administrators are receiving tips and kickbacks, quid pro quo, for Swedish Bofors deal. Do you know how it could be facilitated? How it happened? The reason is, you have Freedom of Information Act available in Sweden since 1766. When? 1766. Much advanced. Long, long ago. I don't know whether you can imagine what our country was during those days. 1766, they are ready to give right to information. We could invent it in 2005. And today we are making all our efforts to kill it. All kinds of amendments we are bringing to shrink it. And I am surprised and I am very sad that there is no sufficient voice coming from the people against the dilution of Right to Information Act. Even today, in spite of the dilution, I would like to tell you, Right to Information is a tool through which you can exercise all your constitutional rights. You can enforce all your legal rights. You can enforce your right, human right to development. you can enforce your right, human right against corruption with Right to Information Act. When such a powerful tool is available to you, not using it is a surprise. Not using it is, it reflects ignorance of law. And you know ignorance of law is? No excuse. But I don't know whether we should excuse ourselves for not having enough knowledge about right to information. In fact, Vice Chancellor was telling me that we should have at least single credit course on Right to Information Act. I totally agree with him, and I'll definitely come and teach one credit course of Right to Information to you if you are interested. But even before that, my request and my suggestion, my recommendation, strong recommendation is, please look into what is happening around in this country. What is happening to administration, and what is that you can do for improvement of the administration? How do you enhance the awareness of rights? How do you bring the information and give it to the people who are in need of it? This is the most important requirement I think you have to do. And Right Information Act is such a tool available to you, available with you. And I'd like to show you this book, the RTI story written by Aruna Rai. Aruna Rai is a former IAS officer. She resigned IAS to live in a small mud structure with a thatched roof in one of the villages of Rajasthan along with two or three colleagues. They never thought of Right to Information. That was not in their agenda and idea. They were simply asking for minimum wages related information. Minimum wages, they are supposed, minimum wage at that time in 1990 was 11 rupees per day. If famine relief work is offered to workers, they are expected to get 11 rupees a day, which is enough for filling the stomach for the day. But the corrupt officers in between, what they were doing was, you have not completed your work, so I am cutting 4 rupees. You have not done that work which I assigned to you, so I am cutting 3 rupees. So nobody used to get complete 11 rupees, though they have completed their work. So generally, what do you ask? If Arun or I or you are there in that village, what do you ask? You show me how much of work I have done, show me the record how much of work I have done, and tell me how much of money I am entitled to get. Will you ask this question or not? And they are not showing. Measurement book, it is called measurement book, they were not showing. And to demand measurement book, Aruna Rai and others thought of asking for right to information. Do you have right to information? Whether I have right to money, right to minimum wages, right to life, right to employment, right to food, that's again a different thing. But do I have right to information at least? You say I have work, and how much of work I tendered, and how much of money I am entitled to, and on what basis you are cutting my 2 rupees out of 11 rupees, or 4 rupees out of 11? Should I know or not? So that was the question. That was a simple question raised in a village that became Right to Information Act in this country, which is available in Sweden in 1766. So are we okay? In a way, I'm very happy. At least now you have asked for right to information and you got it. But what is happening to us all these years and all these decades, even after independence, is the question. So we still need to fight the ignorance, we still need to fight the lack of knowledge, and we still need to fight for official information. Information hidden in files of officers. And you know, there is one act, very interesting act in our country, that is called Official Secrets Act. Have you ever tried to know the meaning of this expression, official secret? When it is official, why should it be secret? It is an oxymoron, don't you think so? Oxymoron. If it is official, I must know. It is official, I must know about it. Except defense secrets. Everything has to be told to me. Because which information you want to hide from me? For what reason? Unless you have corrupt intention, you need not hide any information from me. Even the Supreme Court, there was a very interesting question to Supreme Court judges. Do you know what was the question? How many judges have submitted their assets and liabilities related statement in accordance with 1997 judicial restatement? That was the resolution by the officers personally, judicial officers personally, nobody forced them. They have agreed to submit statement of assets and liabilities every year to the Chief Justice of India. That's all. Not to the Prime Minister, not to the Law Minister. Then the question is not to reveal any statement of assets and liabilities. Don't mistake that, like that. The information sought was how many, you could say 2, 3, 4 out of 50, or you could say none. You could simply give an information zero, it would have been 100% correct answer. But do you know what they did? Supreme Court said, no, 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 we cannot give this information. First of all, it said we don't fall under public authority category and we don't give information. Then the case went to Central Information Commission because judiciary is a centralized, third estate. Then Central Information Commission said, you must give this information. I'm very happy that very boldly the judgment was given by the CIC prior to me. And do you know what government, what Supreme Court did? Supreme Court went to Delhi High Court and said, Delhi High Court, please tell the Central Information Commission that this information cannot be given. Supreme Court appeals to Delhi High Court. And you know what Delhi High Court said? Supreme Court, this information has to be given, please give. Going in appeal.
Go on appeal. One last question before they take on. One I have seen in my experience, there is an information. How far this is correct, they're asking. One question comes to me that, you know, is there a provision like this? And second question, is this provision correct one? Now, is the second question part of RTA? Am I bound to answer?
Yeah, yeah. Generally, what Right Information Act says is, the information available on the record, held by you or controlled by you, has to be given. It doesn't include answers to the questions, generally speaking. But somebody asks your first question. First question is on record, no? What is it? Is there any provision on this aspect? If you have a provision, give it. So, though it is in the form of a question, it refers to some information which is available on the record, give it. Second question is your opinion. He's asking your opinion about the correctness of the provision. Absolutely, you need not give it. Reject it. And RTA doesn't give any right to anybody to ask opinion of a PIO.
Or you wish you can give it. If you are benevolent, you can.
I don't think so. You can do it unofficially, but don't give it on. Don't give it officially. Because there is no. Suppose you say improper, somebody may derive a different inference, and you may be in trouble because you are an officer. I suggest not to do it. And even the applicant should not ask this question. Whether it is proper or not, it is for you to examine. So,
thank you so much for the address, sir. We are now open to a Q&A session, and any interested student can ask the questions. Okay. Too many people. We start from the first row. Ayush.
Thank you, Sankal. Sir, my question is both in your capacity as the CIC and currently as you're an administrator. So, going on the same line of examination answer sheets, it is by now settled that these answer sheets have to be given. Just last week, I believe Madras High Court again weighed in on the issue. So, since the position is so settled, do you think as both an ex-CIC and an administrator that universities should regularize some sort of this whole process of dispersing answer sheet copies instead of leaving students like me to exercise their right under RTI every semester?
Every university has a system where they offer inspection of answer sheet for a fee. Every university, I know, even Usmania University, years ago it has such a system. I think every university has such a system. But what I would like to add, agreeing with you, what I would like to add is, Right to Information Act says, if answer sheet is accessible, it should be accessible at the rate prescribed under the rules of the Act, not at the rate university prescribes. So suggestion is, to all the universities, suggestion and recommendation is, give access to answer sheets and copy of answer sheets at a bare minimum cost. Don't have extra cost for it. Suppose somebody asks for re-verification or review, because it involves a review by another special invigilator, university is free to charge the fee according to their own wisdom, their own understanding, and their own requirement. But as far as access to, that was the decision in Madras High Court. What should be the rate or the price or cost of copying was the question before the High Court. First of all, they said you give the information and you give at the minimum rate of 2 rupees per page, which is considered as prescribed as the cost of reasonable cost of copying. And my suggestion is the best answer sheet should be kept in library. The rest of the answer sheet should be kept with the university for evaluation and recording. And after that recording is over, every answer sheet should be given back to the student. And it is for them to retain it as a souvenir or throw it out. It is for them. That is my suggestion. It is my personal opinion.
Good evening, sir. So my doubt pertains to, in most of the cases what I've seen, in some of the cases maybe, that the information that is asked from a certain authority is excused by way of saying that the particular information is destroyed or the records, as you are saying, is not available anymore. And by way of that, a lot of information is denied.
Yes.
So is there any provision under the IPI Act which says that, which provides a recourse to the same?
Right to Information Act says, held or controlled. Information held or controlled has to be given. Now look at this expression. Now, if it is legally destroyed, that means if it is according to the policy of the authority, certain kinds of documents will be removed after 6 months or 1 year or 2 years. Then it can be denied. It can be denied. If it is destroyed after the Right Information Act is, after RTI application is filed, it's a serious wrong. It could be an offence, and for which penalty can be imposed under penalty clause of Right Information Act. These are the two aspects which are already settled. And every office has power to tell the people that these are the records I am maintaining personally, provisionally, and these are the records I am maintaining permanently, and these are the records available, not available after some time. So that is their policy. They have to do that policy. I cannot dictate. Law cannot dictate. Parliament cannot dictate. It is for the institution to decide. So institution, if you decide to destroy the records after some time, for example, vouchers or bills, how long you retain it? After audit inspection is over, you throw it out. If not, it will consume all of your space. So that, if you ask for the copy of the voucher given by somebody 10 years ago, they can't produce it. It is legally valid to reject it. There is a legal validity. That's what I am saying. It is not provided anywhere. Every public authority has to provide it based on their requirements, their experience and their wisdom. For example, university. University has to say how long it will retain the answer sheets. That's all.
Can I add a little bit of that? For example, across the universities, answer sheets are very varied. Some of the very big universities, they keep it for 1 year. 1 year. The reason is simple. Enormous space is required for stock taking, keeping. It is not just stocking in room. You have to fumigate it because, you know, it will lead to other issues, etc. Some universities have more. For example, I came to understand here, it's 1 year in HNLU. In NLS, it is 5 years. And in NALSAR, it's 3 years. 3 years. What is this reasonable thing is, within the time, as a stakeholder, whatever doubts you have, everything you will clarify. You will not have. So what is the very thing we really don't know? If I asked NLS, they had a very big building outside where they were really stocking all the papers. Then later on, now the demand is that they don't have space and that has to be converted to something. So what do they do? At that point, they thought 5 years is because any case is filed sometime, not RTA those days. When case is filed, court summons something, no? Whether we can have 5 years. But then probably, as you said, that it again is what they think is a reasonable time for people to access. This I'm telling about answer sheets, and he said about vouchers after, you know, audit is over, the vouchers, etc. But degree is what he said, the degree list, what you got, etc., that particular column will be there. So that is the whole thing. Another point could be to today's world of digitization, you can digitize everything. But remember, everything is cost. Digitizing the whole thing means machines. You give me a point. Investment on that and personnel on that, all that stuff. So what is reasonableness of that? You know, there is minimum 1 year. That's in right. Many universities, big universities, you know, and sometimes bigger universities has more students, so more problems. Smaller, medium-sized universities, law schools are definitely smaller, you know, and you should remember, NLS is less than half your strength every year, 400, this is about 900, so you can see accumulation of it. So,
records is a big issue. Maintaining records, retention of records.
But it's very clear. Certain records destruction is not acceptable. Certain records of, because it's not space. If an interview has happened and the interview sheet is definitely not a space to be, you know, destroyed. You know, it has to be kept in custody.
Yeah, sure.
You know, it has to be kept in custody. Because that is very crucial, because you are really talking about a very high level value on that. So that is the situation. But one thing is very clear, after you apply and then it is done, it is a criminal, it's definitely a criminal intent to do that.
Good afternoon, sir. So my question pertains to a specific academic institution. Last year there was this incident when the ICAI published the results of CA final students. After a while, it withdrew those results, and around 39 students who were passed in the earlier results were afterwards declared to be failed. And when an RTI was filed, I think they conceded the fact, saying this is a personal matter or something of that sort. So is there a provision under the RTI which actually makes this transparency possible?
Entire RTI is for that purpose. But then RTI, they are wrong. You have to fight. They are absolutely wrong. And their case will not stand. You have a fair case, you will win it.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes.
Sir, my question is in relation with the recent amendment brought by the central government in the RTI. Mm. Sir, I was thinking of a hypothetical situation. Let's say I am seeking an RTI reply from the central government, and somehow my case has reached before the Chief Information Commission. And the decision of Chief Information Commissioner is in the favor of central government. Since the amendments have now made it clear that it is the central government which would decide the tenure of the Chief Information Commissioner and the salaries from time to time of CICs. So will it not make a classic example of pecuniary bias and personal bias, since it is a quasi-judicial body? And can I not challenge every decision of CIC if it is not passed in my favor?
Why don't you challenge the Amendment Act?
No, but all the
that is important. System is important, no? I have you challenge. Unless you prove that legally it is not there.
It passes the test of like what we have studied in an administrative law, that there
That's
is a, if it is seen that there is real likelihoodness of bias, then the decision can be quelled.
Yeah, you try. Absolutely. What I'm trying to tell you is, second appeal is decided by the Information Commission. If you think that a process is not properly adopted, you have a writ jurisdiction available. Please challenge. There's nothing wrong. You can challenge.
Sir, good evening, sir. In extension to that, can you please talk to us about the extent of dilution that these current amendments will bring to the RTI Act?
Yeah, that's what. The problem with the amendment is, they are trying to make certain things uncertain. What was certain was tenure of the commissioner, status of the commissioner, and salary of the commissioner. They are equated with Supreme Court judges in Central Information Commission. Unless you are kept in a higher position, it is not possible for the CIC to command a cabinet secretary or a principal secretary or chief secretary or PMO to give that information. So I have to, as a commissioner, I have to direct even the registrar of a Supreme Court to give the information. If I am a joint secretary rank officer, how do I give? So that is a basic problem, practical problem. And secondly, unless there is a fixed term, there is no independence. And it says, the amendment also says, amendment doesn't say what is the status that they are going to give me. It doesn't say anything. It says as may be prescribed by the central government. Then what do you mean by from time to time? That means a legislative power has been taken away by the executive and retained by executive, and it will be used from time to time according to its whims and fancies, which will keep the commissioner in tender hooks always, and he will not be in a position to give information, give what is the direction to disclose to the government. That is the whole problem. A very purpose of disclosure mechanism created by Right to Information Act will suffer.
Sir, my question is along the lines of what VC sir asked you. So there is one thing for the university to have a discretion to go through a particular student's answer script. Whereas shouldn't it be a right of...
Answer script of others.
Yes, answer script of others. But shouldn't it be a right of a particular student to go through an answer script of another student because he has a reason to believe that there is a... Like there is going to be an unfair marking scheme because there are separate teachers teaching the same subject, and it should not depend on the consent of that person, because if he denies, then my purpose will not be fulfilled.
That was what the decision in CBSE case also. What they stated was, there is no provision and there is no reason available, generally speaking, to prevent access to that kind of information sought by the applicant. But they carved out an exception to UPSC and CBSC and organizations similar to that on the ground of expedience. That's all. Legally speaking, what you said is correct. But there are certain issues which Professor Vice Chancellor Vivekanandan has pointed out. And there could be an element of public interest where an individual right is going to be affected. Suppose I can show that if you release this information, my right is going to be affected. I think my right also has to be taken into account, where the zero marks example was given by the professor. But technically, as I'm today speaking, what you stated is available in Right to Information as a right. If they establish, that's a big if. Suppose you come to the court and say, I got zero marks and I don't want anybody to talk about my zero marks. It will be a personal insult to me. Then maybe there is a possibility. I don't rule it out. But as on today, there is no rule to say yes to no to it. As on today, there is no rule. But privacy is coming up in a very big way. It could be a serious question. We cannot, we may not ignore it. Yes.
And sir, my question is related to in Service Selection Board SSB for candidates getting into National Defence Academy and Indian Military Academy and OTA. They simply not qualified and they being conferenced out or screened out, being in first day only. They don't have any means to ask the authorities or the CO or commandant of that SSB that why I am not being selected. There is no any provision.
Party is there.
Sir, but they don't allow that.
Well, who are they not to allow it? It's a parliamentary enactment. Applicable all over the country, including the Defence Department. Sir, including the Defence Department.
Sir, but in SSB we can't get...
They are threatening perhaps. I don't know what exactly they are doing, but you question it.
Except for military strategies and operational things of defense. What you are talking is about recruitment.
Even the exempted organizations have to give recruitment information.
If they deny, you have to go on appeal.
Sir, but they simply told.
Did they give it in writing?
No, sir, but they say.
That's the reason they don't give it in writing.
But they say, analyze yourself and you see your own mistakes. We can't give you anything in writing, or we can't say to you something.
Yeah, about they cannot say. I agree with that. They cannot say. They cannot give anything in writing about why you are not selected. But they have to share the records. if there is a record, the professor was talking about comparative table after your interviews. If that table is there, they have to share it. They may not give reasons. Why I am not selected means how can anybody give you reasons? That they need not give. But if they have anything on record to show that you are falling short of so-and-so, 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 they must give.
Good evening, sir.
Yes.
My question is related to criminal law and like there's a new trend in the courts nowadays where evidences are given in sealed covers. So isn't it a violation of the other party's right to information?
Whether that happened in a writ petition or a trial court?
Trial court.
Trial courts, nothing is admissible without cross-examination, without proper presentation of evidence before the court of law. Nothing is admissible.
True, sir. Sir, I was reading the files of Patribal fake encounter case where a court martial happened and the sessions court basically agreed with the court martial and the other party is trying to question it, but there is no information that they have. From the court martial, it says that the defense private information. And they cannot give it to the other party.
The only defense available is privileged communication under Evidence Act. If it is privileged communication, the claim of privileged communication, it can be disputed. It can be appealed for. So you can go up to Supreme Court and take a call. And let the Supreme Court decide whether it is a really privileged information or not. That's what happened in Indira Gandhi case, you know. When her election was challenged, she did not give the information, or the government did not give the information about the blue book and security arrangements done by a public servant in her election campaign meeting. She claimed it as a privileged information. Then Rajanaran went up to Supreme Court. And Supreme Court said that unless you show a present day threat, you cannot prevent it. So it is no more privileged information, it was given. And because that was given, her election was found invalid. I think you can take the issue to upper levels.
It's there in the Supreme Court. The question is pending. It's been pending for years.
Wait for Supreme Court.
No, sir. The question is, can a court martial be a privileged information then?
Generally not, but I don't know what exactly the facts situation in your case. Suppose it is something which relate to sexual crime. Which the facts they don't want to be revealed in general, or in camera powers are exercised by the court. I don't know.
It's a fake encounter case where people claim that
clearly a case they are trying to hide it, and you have to fight until the end of it. You have to go to the bottom of the case and take up to the top level of the court.
We'll have a last question.
Good afternoon, sir. So my question pertains to academic qualifications. So for example, a person is questioning my educational degrees and I have received a post-graduation degree from a foreign institution. So can he ask about my, for example, I have received my PhD degree from a foreign educational institution. So can he question that?
You can. Yes.
Good evening, sir.
Foreign is no exception. Being foreign is not. Yes.
Good evening, sir. Sir, my question pertains to the recent debate we had about whether or not you are entitled to check a third person's answer sheet.
Hmm.
Now, while I understand that, you know, a person who has gotten the highest marks may, and someone who hasn't gotten the highest marks want to see that person's particular answer sheet. However, what are the repercussions of that? Because say I look at my friend's answer sheet who's gotten the highest marks and I'm losing out by 0.5. I compare her answers to the model answer sheet and I see that there are certain places where she's gotten slightly extra marks. Then what are the repercussions of that? Because I think this entire interplay between privacy and transparency will end up just being a bigger burden on the administration if they're asked to again reevaluate their answer sheet.
Yes, it's a burden. But when they...
Prof, there's a different angle to this. If somebody, I said two things. One is regular exam and what do you say? One is like a job recruitment, what he said. This first case, what professor says is, it happened long back in the early 80s. In Thailand, especially, it triggered a lot of things. One parent could not get the daughter admitted in a school because she failed in the, or she was lower in the competitive results. But another person whom she knows, that person's daughter got in. And they very well know that particular daughter, according to them, very below average. So they demanded that if that one person has got in, that not means his daughter is the next in the waitlist. Then they ordered, because here is a question of somebody losing out to someone, if it is proven. So what they said was, you have this legal guarantees. It's a gag order. You can only see those, verify to yourself. If you found something, you can go on appeal. Otherwise, you know, you are not supposed to maintain the privacy. You should write that guarantee. It was there. Your question of 0.5 mark, 1 mark, let me tell you. If the question and subject, what you mean is the mathematics, where there is a right answer, wrong answer, it makes sense. But if it is a subject matter of law, a teacher, one teacher to another teacher, same paper will have even 2-3 marks. That's why in revaluation, what happens, up to 5 marks is allowed between the first revaluation, first correction and the second revaluation. If it is more than 5 marks, it goes for a third revaluation. Because sensibly speaking, two teachers cannot differ, around 5 marks difference will be there. And let me tell you, if I start correcting answer sheet fresh in the morning and the same answer class answer sheet later in the evening, you will see a very difference. Yes. And let me tell you, if my wife is very upset that day, at that time I correct papers, it will be different than in some other time. So this variation of 0.5, what you say, that these are all what you call us, then another person will correct, he will again put you down. But what you say is significant cases, that's what he said. I lose out a gold medal. You know, there again, it's a difference. If it is 1 mark, 2 mark, there is a chance you can ask, provided you take care of the privacy of the other person or whatever it is. There is a possibility, in my opinion. So the answer is not a black and white, it's a gray area. The answer is yes and no, depending upon context, what he said and what he said. 0.5% I'll tell you. 0.5% is, there is no objection, especially humanities, social science, even in science, narrative paper, how can you know? Because your language will be different, your communication style, the teacher might, you know, think different. These questions will come, except for a objective type question.
Okay.
That is very clear. In objective type question exam, you can always ask, because either it has to be a right answer or wrong answer. You know, or mathematics, where you know this formula will lead to only to this answer. You have something to ask.
I have a question. Actually, you were clarifying 5 marks. So whether you are talking about the percentage or, for example, 30 marks, full mark is 30 and 5 mark can be changed.
In NALSAR, what we have is, if you are asking for a revaluation, if the revaluation is done, the second correction and the first correction, if it is within a variance of, you say percentage means 5 marks is the variation meaning, 5 marks. It may be higher or lower. The danger is, if it is lower, you have to take the lower, not the higher, because you are challenging. But if it is higher, the 5 marks to be given. But if it is more than 5, say 10 or 15, then the problem is not that I am telling the other person is wrong, you are right. We go to a third person.
For example, sir, the full mark is 5. And what would be the percentage of that error that you are telling?
I didn't get it.
For example, you are checking 100 mark question paper, that the variation could be 5, or it is full mark is 5, the variation could be 5 also.
Full paper only we are checking, no? See, you are asking, it could be, your final exam can be a 50 mark or 60 mark, no? You are talking percentage variation or mark variation. We had a rule, mark variation. mark variation of 5. It could be a 50 mark paper. There are some LLM which is 100 marks. Give me a point, they take 5. So 5 out of 100 and 5 out of 50 could be 10%. They give me a point. But people are correcting marks, so they give. But the purpose I am driving home is to, there will be a clear flexibility of 5, you call it percentage or marks, whichever system you adopt. There is a possibility between two standard teachers who have a standard experience of correcting a paper, because I always consider all these things, the objectivity is within the subjectivity of the teacher. You are going to tell teachers not subjective in paper like this, or humanities and other things, all of us are subjective.
So one more point I want to add to your answer to that girl's question is, your question is based on the assumption that two answers are the same, which will never happen. That factors the importance of the information. So that's why I was searching for a better example to make you realize the importance of information. I'm happy that your vice chancellor given it to me. So this is what I want to tell you. I can't go on the entire sections and explaining them and case law. I don't want to do all that. In the course we'll do 14 lectures we need, for 16 or 14, we need for that. But now I want to answer your questions on right to information or anything related to it. I think I have given sufficient information for you from my side. There are two aspects. Yeah.
About specific queries if you have, but on issues of RTI.
I tell you, there are two aspects of right to information. Just after telling this, after this you can start asking questions. Two aspects of right to information. One is transparency. That is, I will give information which I have. I will tell about what I do. I mean, if I am an institution, I will tell what I am going to do. Second part is, if the information given by me voluntarily, suomoto, is not sufficient, you can ask the information which is available, held or controlled by me, I give. So these are the two aspects. So I fulfilled the first aspect of Right to Information Act by telling you the introductory aspect of or importance of information. Now I leave it to you. If you have.
Before they do start, I was wondering whether you handle the entire MHRD.
Yes.
What is that which you found with sometimes from invalidating institutes or universities?
Which are not
in universities, you know, what you find very startlingly,
yes,
what you saw the Supreme Court appealing to Supreme Court,
yeah,
you know, to get my point,
yes,
can a Vice Chancellor appeal to the Vice Chancellor?
Which Vice Chancellor? Okay, most sought after information when I was dealing with MHRD was verification of degree. Now you know, most of the people doubt the genuineness of the degrees held by some people. Or most of the people. Now, when you get a doubt, I will give my own example. Why should I take anybody's name? Suppose you doubt, what this man, Professor Vivekananda, said, he studied that, studied this, he did his LLM there, PhD there, here, LLD there. So if one of you are from Visakhapatnam, if you doubt my LLD, do you have a right to verify my degree? Is the question. What do you say? Whether degree is your private information, personal information, or is it public information, or is it such an information that anybody, Tom, Dick and Harry, can come and verify? Or is such a confidential information you are not supposed to reveal, unless you want to reveal in your CV? What do you think? Anybody from you? Is it an open information or confidential information? Number one. Is it a privileged information or private information or public information? Degree?
Public
na? Generally, common sense suggests you it should be public. Now I tell you why it is public information. Your admission is open admission, competitive admission, advertised, notified, you applied, and then all of you eligible to write examination were invited, facilitated, you write, in competition you win, and there is a merit list prepared by computer. and according to quota, seats available and the preference of students you get, and nobody has any control at any place. You get your list by merit. And then you study 60 or different number of students, strength of students in different classes you study. You get a degree after getting imparted with education. You write a public examination and it is evaluated by the people equally, generally by internal or external evaluation. Then your degree is declared, you are passed. And then where do you get your degree? In your convocation, because most of you are waiting for convocation. I don't expect you to answer this question, but every degree is given in convocation. What is the convocation? It's a celebration where first citizen of the state will come. Who is the first citizen of state? Governor. Governor is what is he? Chancellor. Chancellor will come and Vice Chancellor will present the list of the students. Chancellor will give the degrees, and before he gives the degrees, he will take an oath from you. What oath? You remember, all those who have taken degrees must have remembered their oath. That oath is, sir, I am conferred with this degree, I will live in tune with, in accordance with the dignity of the degree. That is the promise you are going to make to the society. That means what? From the stage of admission to passing out and getting your degree, it is a public affair, not a private affair. And you know what is the meaning of registrar? You have a registrar, no? What is the duty of registrar? To maintain the records of degrees. That is the fundamental duty. All the rest of things are different. All that is needed to keep records, he has to do that. But main function is to, of the registrar is, no record can be destroyed with relation to degrees of the students. Even if my university is 110-year-old university, the first convocation degrees have to be listed, their marks have to be made available to the verification. That is the public openness of the degrees offered by the educational institutions. How can you say that this is a private information? And I'd like to tell you, because you are all going to be lawyers, Bar Council of India chairman once went on record saying that 60% of the degrees offered by the offered to the or claimed by the lawyers are fake. I am not saying it. Who said? Bar Council of India chairman. 60% includes who? Lawyers? Lawyers? Will it stop with lawyers? It will also include judges. So, and includes lecturers and professors like me also. So, when all of us are lawyers and holding law degree, and somebody doubts my law degree, why not he verify my marks in the university by verifying the records held by a registrar? Why not? So, this is the most fundamental question that is being. Now, do you know what is the stage of this case? Whether degree related information is a private information or not is being deliberated before Delhi High Court, division bench, and we do not know when they will come and give final judgment. My judgment was, it is a public information, you have to give. It was stayed, and I am waiting for the confirmation by the court. World over it is public information. Then I have another question, simple question. I know most of you are not married, but all of you will be definitely going to be married. No, whether the marriage, this is private information, correct? The question before me was, whether marriage certificate and marriage certificate related information is private information or public information?
Public.
Huh?
It's a matter of public record.
What are you saying?
It's a matter of public record.
Public. Anybody to say private? Anybody who say private can raise your hand? Unless you consider that also, opinion also is private. One fellow came to me in second appeal. He was asking for certified copies of marriage certificates of his wife. Certified copies of marriage certificates of his wife. Then I was wondering, did I hear wrongly? Or was there anything terrible? Then I asked, are you sure? What are you asking? He said, yes sir, I have my marriage certificate with my wife. But I am asking her earlier marriages related certificates. If that is the case, should they have, should it be given or not? It should be given. And it's a big problem. And why do you register once? First of all, tell me, why do you register a marriage? So that you create evidence, number one. You create a possibility of verification, number two. And prior to these two, there is another importance, another very important purpose for the registration. Giving notice to the whole world that A is going to marry B. So it is not private. Everything after marriage is private. But regarding marriage and happening of the marriage and celebration, why do you celebrate marriage? When there was no process of registration for the marriage, celebration was the process of registration. You celebrate, now the celebration itself, the invitation to others itself is creation of evidence and giving notice to the whole of the world that these are the going to be legally wedded couple. So what I am trying to tell you is, an information which is supposed to be in public domain should be in public domain. And academic institutions should give. There is one another interesting area that came before me was PhD thesis. The PhD thesis was done by a scholar under the supervision of a professor with the facilities of the university, and the copy of one of the copies of the PhD thesis, which was successfully defended, will be kept in where? Library. Why do you keep it in library? To open it and somebody should study it. Now tell me, is it a copyrighted private information of a scholar, or is it an information authored by scholar but authorized by university? And when a university is a state university or a university registered under a state enactment or central enactment, is that a private document? Suppose you have published a book and it is copyrighted, fine, you take the economic benefits of that copyrighted book. But can you keep it away from the access of the people? You cannot. So there was a question for a copy of for access to PhD thesis, which was contended. Then I said it's an open book and you have to provide access to that. So there are so many questions and degree related information. What is that? Courses related information. You can ask for it. And regarding appointments of professors, appointments of faculty, or works, tenders, or activities, development activities, you can ask for it. Academy related, public activity related information is public information. You can ask for it. And then there was a very interesting aspect of examination paper and answer sheets. Whether question paper, copy of the earlier question paper can be had. Then some scientists who were struggling to give a very good question paper based on their research and studies, they claimed that it is my intellectual property. This question paper is my intellectual property. Why should I give? Then my answer to that question is, it is your intellectual property, right? We are not disputing it. But will you give your question paper to exam to all? Knowledge is available to all. Before you apply for patent, you search for it, no? Prior art. When it is part of prior art, how can you say this information cannot be given? So our environmental department, Ministry of Environment Department scientist was defending against the disclosure on the ground of patent. I said, this is the meaning of the patent. You have to give the information. And you stop him if he is producing something commercial. I have no problem. So that was a case, but in exceptional cases, the intellectual property aspect of question paper was accepted. In exceptional cases. Then the next important debate was about answer sheet. Can we have copy of answer sheet? I think most of the students will be interested in knowing it. And in law schools, I think you are made available of answer sheets and you know. And you can also see the answer sheets of the others. Probably. Are you? No. You are more interested in seeing the answer sheets of the others than yourself. No, that was the question before the Supreme Court in a CBSE case. You know, CBSE conducts examinations for lakhs of students. Lakhs of students. And it is very difficult to handle the RTI applications demanding the access to answer sheets. Very difficult. So the Supreme Court said, every student is entitled to have access to his own answer sheet, provided it is available and not destroyed according to the record keeping policy of the institution. So first of all, you must have a policy. How long you will keep your record? It is up to you. Law will not dictate any policy. Law says if you have a policy, follow it. Suppose you have a policy to retain it for 5 years or 3 years or 1 year or 2 years or 6 months. The petitioner can ask for access within 6 months only, and after destruction of the record, I think it is not possible, physically possible to gain access. Then the question is with reference to answer sheet of the others, can you ask? Then there are two questions before Supreme Court. If it is a competitive examination and if the people, candidates who appeared for the examination are less and in a practically possible numbers, yes, it is possible. If it is impossible, for example, for CBSE and UPSC, it is impossible, there it is not. If the Supreme Court allowed the institutions not to give the copies of answer sheets of other candidates, that is the legal situation today. But in a recruitment exam, suppose there are two posts vacant and you conducted an examination, 20 people attended, 2 got selected, 2 were given job, and 18 persons want to know what these 2 persons have written in their answer sheet. In my judgment, I said Supreme Court judgment did not carve out a separate exception beyond Right to Information Act. But it said for the sake of administrative convenience, they prevented the organizations, or they gave a choice to organizations not to give access to the answer sheets of the other persons. But here, when 20 people are there, there is no difficulty, practical difficulty. And there is no Supreme Court bar on it. And Right Information Act doesn't have any provision under which you can say that I cannot give this information. So I said you have to give this information. It is not challenged so far. I think it is the law today. Any other question with reference to educational institutions, if you want, please ask.
I will begin with the last you said. You said competitive and recruitment, which means if somebody gets elevated or selected, there is a possibility somebody deprived. That's what we understand in us. What happens in regular, for example, in law school, you have an exam paper. You might say cumulatively somebody will get a gold medal, but a paper is there. So I want, say, 60 students. This is not a very big number. So I want to check 10-15 students' information. It's not a competitive exam, it's an independent exam.
It is 60, it is practically possible and it is your discretion, you can give. But if you deny, what exactly the legal position? Technically speaking, my order covers only the parties to the order. Because I'm not a court of records. My order is not law for all. But as on today, the legal position is only UPSC and CBSE and the organizations like that who are handling thousands and lakhs of answer sheets are exempted from giving access to third parties' request for answer sheet. Otherwise, there is no.
Now, I am asking one different interpretation. I am asking another person. It doesn't say whether somebody got high marks or low marks. I want to know how that fellow got zero. I want this paper. I read all the stuff.
Very useful.
I am asking one question of privacy. I read all this. And then the other person is objecting. He goes and spreads everywhere. You know what nonsense you have written? Why you got zero, you know? Because of this. There is a possibility there.
Yeah.
So don't you think there is a privacy? Yeah. I am asking a question.
Yes.
There is a privacy involved. What I have written.
81J covers it. You have a provision under Indian Right to Information Act where it says there is no public interest in it. You need not give. And where privacy is claimed, privacy is seen, you need not give.
I agree with you, it goes two ways. For example, I want to favor a student. I give him more marks and then he makes the cut in terms of a grade or a thing. And I suspect this teacher is always favoring him. So I want to know his paper. That is one angle.
Correct.
Another angle, once I open the Pandora's box, then you know, everybody, whomever I want, I can, you know, what you call us. And how do I get that? Am I shown or I'm given a photocopy? If I give a photocopy, what is the conditionality? This photocopy is again a private information for you to see and keep it to you, or I go and put it in notice board, or I scan and send it in WhatsApp.
That's what privacy, personal.